Holistic Sports, Foundation Physiotherapy, and Georgetown Honda present Out of the Park with Barry Davis. This week,
we talk to Marco Estrada as he begins to look at life beyond the game of baseball.
Golf is doing it for me. You know, if I don't ever come back to play baseball, I'm okay with it. I'm pretty happy right now.
And now, here's a guy that probably shouldn't be playing golf or baseball, to be honest. Probably going to end up hurting himself. Barry Davis!
Or hurt others, Tom.
Or hurt others, yeah. Yes. What's that phrase again? Four?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm.
The good news is I can't hit the ball hard enough to actually hurt somebody with it, so that's good news. Hey, folks, welcome to Out of the Park. There's Tom, I'm Barry, and we've got a great show for you. And why are we talking about golf on Out of the Park? Well, it just so happens that our guest, former Blue Jays pitcher Marco Estrada, has been playing a lot of it lately, and we'll find out why when he joins us. Tom, this is also going to mark our largest Zoom group yet. We had, I think, 7 or 8 Out of the Park insiders all jammed in with Marco Estrada, and it was a blast.
Yeah, absolutely. And people from all over the world. Really, really special, really big show.
Yeah.
Can't wait for everyone to see it.
Yeah, it's going to be a great reunion as our pal from Pakistan, Usman, is going to join us. Huge Marco Estrada fan. He will get to actually talk to Marco for the first time. So this is going to be a lot of fun. We're also going to talk with our pal Rob Paya. Why? Why wouldn't we? All we can talk about with the Blue Jays these days are injury. Everyone is getting injured with the Blue Jays. We're going to focus mainly on a couple of the big ones, including this new injury, which is an old injury to George Springer, and Alejandro Kirk, who could be on the shelf for quite a while. Up next, though, Tom, we have some prizes to give away, and we're going to be joined by a good friend of ours who used to come on this show quite often. There's Tom. I'm Barry. And you're listening and watching Out of the Park.
A play-ball!
Ladies and gentlemen, girls and boys, the first pitch with Barry Davis.
Tom, we've got some big news to announce here on Out of the Park, as we've got a contest coming up. And joining us to talk about that contest is somebody that we have known for quite a few years, really since the inception of Out of the Park. And it's so great to be working again with Julia and the Jaywalk. And Julia, first of all, great to have you on the show. I hope things have been going well. And let's get a plug right off the top, because we know COVID has really caused a lot of companies like yourselves to suffer for a while. Blue Jays are playing well. Fans are getting excited. They're seeing all these great shirts online. How can they pick one up?
Well, we have our website. That's the primary place to get any of our gear. We have collections for the Blue Jays, the Raptors, the Maple Leafs. So we have all of the big three major Toronto sports teams covered. If you're a fan, we probably have something that you would enjoy. The jaywalk.com is our website. You can find all of our merch on there. And we're excited that baseball's back in full swing, and you know, things are picking up again, and it's been great for us so far.
And for those watching, you can see Tom and myself both sporting the Out of the Park shirts, which have made this surge over the last month. People are wanting these shirts again. So I'm wearing the black. Tom's got the blue. You can get it in white. But again, this is something people can still purchase, right?
Yeah, on our website. We still have the Out of the Park shirts. And yeah, it's been awesome to see people posting on Twitter and Instagram wearing the shirt. So it's nice that people are supporting the podcast.
Well, you know, the Out of the Park is my personal favorite of the shirts that you have at the Jaywalk. But I have to admit, and I'd love to give a shout out to the dome shirts that you have.
Yeah, it's been so popular lately. It's crazy.
It's something we talked about on the show, and, you know, it's a little bit of a controversial thing in Toronto. I'm a diehard old school Blue Jays fan, so it was always the dome to me. Rob Ducey echoed that sentiment just a couple weeks ago, and I love seeing it in a shirt. So, you know, of all the products that you carry, what is the most popular for you, or does it change with the sports season?
It does, because we try to release a new collection every season and keep up with, you know, what's going on. You know, if something happens during a game, we can kind of make it into a shirt pretty much almost instantly. I mean, Barry knows from when that really popular interview with Josh Donaldson, and we made the We Like Our Team Barry shirt, and that kind of went viral overnight, and it was crazy. But This season, it's been it's called Sky Dome shirt for sure. I think a lot of people, you know, with the discussion of, you know, do we knock down Rogers Center and build something new? But I think a lot of the old school fans still call it Sky Dome, even before my time, and I still call it Sky Dome. So that's probably been the most popular shirt this year so far.
So we have you on today not only to, you know, remind our listeners and viewers what a great company you are, but also to let them know that we have some stuff that we're going to give away. And we're going to have two winners that we're going to announce, and we're going to announce them, let's say at the end of the month, okay? And what we're going to have you do is we're going to have a prize for anyone that listens or watches this program. And if you are an Out of the Park insider, you have a chance to win an even bigger prize, which is cool as well. So before you tell everyone what it is that they will be able to choose from, we're going to let you know that we are going to, over the next few days, we're going to reveal it over social media, what the trivia question is going to be. We're going to have a trivia question. And the first OTP insider that gets it right will win a prize pack, and the first non-OTP insider will win a pack as well. So what can the lucky winners look forward to choosing?
So the non-member winner, to guess correctly first, will win a t-shirt of their choice, so they can pick any design that they like on our website, and that'll be their prize. And the bigger prize pack for an OTP member will be a prize pack that consists of a hoodie of their choice, some t-shirts of their choice. We'll do two t-shirts, a hat, and then any of our accessory items that they would like to add, and we'll make it a nice big build your own prize pack, so to speak, and we'll throw some other Blue Jay swag in there as well.
That is awesome. The new line is out right now, and as we speak, you can see some pictures of some of the new shirts that are out for the 2021 season. Julia, how much effort and how much work, and even kind of battling over, do I like this one? Do I like that one? When you're putting these designs together, because you can only do so many, right? Do you have a lot of good ideas that kind of end up getting cut because you just don't have room for all of them?
Some do. And I mean, I'm a graphic designer by trade, so a lot of times it's just, you know, stuff that's more aesthetically pleasing, or a lot of times we'll release stuff as the season goes on. So like I said, you know, if something happens during a game, we can put on a t-shirt and kind of release newer stuff as time goes on. But we try to create different designs. I think that, you know, the possibilities are endless, but when we do release a new collection, we just try to have a different approach every season, so to speak.
Was it harder to determine an approach this season with the, you know, the environment, you know, the baseball actually being down south, everybody in Ontario could use a little bit of a pick me up. Did it make it harder, or did it make it a little bit easier to start having some fun with them?
There were some that were pretty fun, like the Buffalo, New York, when they were housed in Buffalo versus, you know, at home in Canada. That was a fun one. And a lot of times, you know, fans will suggest something to put on a shirt that they would love to see. That was one. And we kind of just played on, you know, a map of the state of New York and renamed Buffalo Boflo for Beau Bichette. So there were some designs that were easier because of that, you know, circumstances, but it's hard when, you know, for a time there was nothing happening, and it's just like, what can you do? You know, you can only do so many Toronto oriented designs. You know, fans like to see stuff that's different. So it helps that stuff is happening and continuing to happen. So.
Well, Julia, while you were saying that, I finally came up with an idea for a trivia question.
Okay.
So for those watching and listening, you get first dibs on this trivia question. And the trivia question is, and if you're a loyal listener or viewer, this should be easy for you. Tell us the name of three former Toronto Blue Jays that we have Zoomed with since we switched over to video. Pretty simple. Just give us names of three former Blue Jays that you have seen on Out of the Park. And the first non-member and the first member will each win a prize from the Jaywalk. Julia, where can people, again, let's get that last plug in, where can they find you?
Our website where you can purchase any of our items is www.thejwalk.com. You can find us on all social media platforms, Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, @the_jwalk. And that's where anyone can find us.
Foundation Physiotherapy presents The Medical Room.
Our good pal, Raj Sapaya, joins us from Foundation Physiotherapy. New background this week. I like it.
Fueled by Foundation.
I love it. I love it. And you don't seem to get caught up in it like you used to with the other logo.
Right?
Yes, this is a bit better, yeah.
It's a bit better.
Yeah, it works better.
So,
before we get to the current injuries, Raj, first of all, I want to say you nailed it when we talked about Ryu, saying that, don't worry, it's not a long-term thing, and he's back. So you're absolutely right about that. Before we get to Alejandro Kirk, who is out with the hip flexor injury, we did talk a couple weeks ago about George Springer and the quad. And running to first base, he re-injures the quad, and now he's back on the injured list again. Does it surprise you that, A, he was back as soon as he was, and B, that he re-injured it as quickly as he did?
To the rehab they're getting and the amount of work they're putting into their training, right? Some athletes like are just built stronger and they work harder. It's really hard to come up with that formula. If he got back in too soon, is that something ingrained in the athlete, or is that something that's in the rehab regimen that the trainers aren't testing before getting him out there into those levels of speed? So I mean, they have all the high tech devices and everything to make sure that these guys can handle the power and the sprinting and the load that they should be able to. So where is that inconsistency? It's really hard to tell, guys. But yeah, I mean, of course, you know, when you have an injury, it's easy to get re-injured if you go back in too soon. So
first of all, he got injured and it took a little bit longer than, you know, we were informed initially for him to come back, and now he's right back out again. And you're right, it could be a player thing, it could be a training thing, but there's actually been a number of Blue Jays, it seems to be a sort of a pattern this year, with the club disclosing an injury that it's like they'll be back today, they'll be back tomorrow, and oh, okay, now all of a sudden it's not, and they keep stepping it back. And so it seems to be a pattern of these Blue Jay players taking much longer than initially thought to heal. So would you look at something like that and think maybe we are rushing the players back? Could that be a team problem rather than a player problem?
Oh, 100%. I mean, like, you know, I really feel like the medical team is so integral into the, it's like an IT department of a company, right? Like you need that mainframe to work. So like the medical team is so important, and they're almost like, you know, and if you're not going to throw the right money and the right kind of, you know, brain power at it, you're not going to get the results you want. And if you try to rush things too soon, I know, for example, I'll go back to basketball, like the Raptors, they made their head physiotherapist assistant coach. That's a smart move because now he has powers and he works with the GM so closely because his real outcome is looking at health. Sometimes there is a like, you know, conflict between the management and having to get these players back in because they want to utilize their dollars versus the medical team. So, you know, And we never hear about it on the media, what the changes in the medical team, but I think a lot of inconsistencies in medical teams and doctors leaving and trainers leaving can totally affect the team's health and the team's performance. Those are the things they don't talk about. We talk about the injuries, but we don't talk about what goes behind it. So for sure, I think if we're seeing that consistently, there has to be some sort of like revamping of the internal structure within the medical organization of the Jays.
Raj, whenever we talk about injuries, there's usually the part of the body followed by what the injury is, a bruised knee, a strained quad. But whenever you hear hip flexor, you just hear, he's got a hip flexor. Well, what's the injury? Is the hip flexor the area? Is a flexor the injury? Like, it's got to be one of the most confusing things, and it seems to be the only part of the body where they don't actually say what it is. They just say, he's got a hip flexor.
Well, yeah, they say they have a hip flexor injury, and I think that's just I think what happens, and I think every league, to be honest, after doing this with you guys and doing NFL and Major League and NBA, I think every league has categories. That's what I've noticed. I've noticed in certain sports they release a bit more information, and then in Major League it's just like quad strain, glute strain, hip flexor injury. So I think every sport has its way of releasing information to the media. And I've actually, the more of these interviews I've done and looking up these injuries, I'm like, huh. You know, I've noticed some leagues are a lot more forthcoming and others aren't, which might speak to Major League itself as an organization.
So what would cause one to suffer a hip flexor injury, and where is exactly it?
So the hip flexor, so to that point, the hip flexor is in the front of your hip. It's what lifts your leg up. So if you think of like walking upstairs and having to lift your leg up off the ground, right? That is a hip flexor. It kind of starts at the top of your thigh and goes kind of into like your abdominal region. It's not a huge muscle in comparison to things like the quads and the hamstrings and the glutes, but it's important in lifting your hip off the ground. So if you think of any forward movement, running, jumping, you know, sprinting, anything like that in which you have to lift your leg up off the ground, the hip flexor is involved. It's quite commonly injured. And so that's where the hip, it's called the hip flexor. There's a larger kind of proper anatomical name for it, but we kind of just call it the hip flexor. And that's what people would call it as. So imagine the muscle that's right in front of your hip that's responsible for keeping your hip bent.
I think the question on a lot of Blue Jays fans' lips is probably going to be, is this one of those injuries that might roll into the 10-day, maybe 60-day injured list?
So to be honest, unlike the glute, the hip flexor is, like I said, more commonly injured. And I do think it's going to be more than 10 days. Again, earlier in the season, they might want to rehab him. It's a smaller muscle. It's likely his tendon that's probably irritated or inflamed. So there's probably going to be some pinching that's happening in there and not as much power he can drive from that leg. So I have a feeling they're probably putting him on a 10-day, but they'll probably extend it a bit longer. From even what I've seen with just the regular population getting hip flexor injuries, you know, especially to go back to that kind of load with what the athletes have to do, you're probably looking at more than 10.
Raj, one thing I have in common with Kirk is I'm not very fleet of foot. I'm not the speediest guy. And when I was playing sports, sometimes I would overextend myself to keep up. So as a slower guy, and you could see it because he was really busting it down the first baseline, and he's not the fastest guy in the world. When you are a slower runner, is it even more vital to stretch and prepare certain muscles? Because times, especially when you're highly competitive, you're going to be pushing probably a little bit harder than someone who just glides down the first baseline.
100%. That's where strength is going to be important, right? Like if you just don't have that natural speed, or if your size is a bit bigger, there's some things you just can't change on your body type. So, you know, in a guy like Kirk, if he's had this occur, it's probably going to be part of his program is to keep his hips strong, because he's going to be driving a lot of force through his hips to be able to sprint. Or I would say just start hitting home runs. That's what some of the big guys used to do back then, right? Just hit home runs. You don't have to worry about
method.
Yeah.
So how do you treat a hip flexor strain?
What kind of things can you do?
Lots of things. So first thing we would do is reduce the inflammation. You know, we'd obviously take him off of what's irritating him. So rest is going to be the first thing. Rest from his sport. Rest from any sort of aggressive movements. Calming down the inflammation. So that could be done through some soft tissue techniques, some manual techniques, some massage, even some like cold compress can help reduce some of the irritation in there, right? And then finally, you want to work into stretching and strengthening. So stretching would be if the hip flexor is against the muscle that bends your hip forward, you want to stretch it the other way, right? Open it up, do some passive stretches, teach the athlete some active stretching as well to extend the leg, and then strengthen the whole thing. So a lot of the muscles around strengthening his abs, strengthening his hip, and so on. So that's the whole gamut of it. And then after the strengthening part, you put him back into you get him back into the sport.
Right? Raj, we already have seen how hip you are on this show. Now we need to see you flex.
Ooh, nice one.
No. I'm being honest. We've seen you hip.
You can't see him.
Ah, there he is. Drop singing my way. Do I have to keep on talking till I can go on? Wanna see it your way. The risk of knowing that our love may soon be gone. We can work it out. We can work it out. Think of what you say.
Life is very short, and Marco, we've had you on this show many times before. We've never had you on via video before. So now you get to see what I look like all these years later.
Oh, man. Yeah, I wish we weren't doing it this way, but.
Okay. The last couple times we've had you on the show, I may have prematurely announced that you are retiring from playing in the major leagues. Are we now officially ready to say that you are retired from Major League Baseball? Or are you still in it or what?
I'm still working. I've been working out quite a bit, actually. I feel pretty good. But it's one of those things that if I was going to play, I didn't want to play a full season just with the whole protocols and, you know, the COVID thing going around. It's just, it's one of those things I just don't want to deal with. And if I can't be around my friends and family, it's not worth it. But, I'm not playing right now, obviously. And I don't know if I'm 100% ready to say I'm done, but I probably am.
That's pretty good. That's as close as we've gotten to an official, which sucks because I want to see you keep pitching.
Right. Oh, yeah. No, obviously. And I wish I was, but, you know, injuries are injuries and I'm old now.
Have you given any thought to your next steps after the game?
I haven't. I've been playing a lot of golf and I want to get good at it, but I think it's going to take me years to become good at it. But no thoughts right now. Just enjoying life, hanging out with the kids, you know, the family, the wife, just enjoying being home. It's been a lot of fun the last year and a half or so.
Which is interesting because when we talk to players that have stepped away from the game, there's that kind of torn in the middle thing. They feel great that, oh yeah, they get to be with their family. They're catching up on things they haven't done. But then there's this void, and 9 times out of 10 it's a competitive void that's not there, and they have to find ways of filling it. So what have you been doing to fill that void?
That's golf is doing it for me. And you're right,
our golf courses are still closed, by the way, so we can't even golf yet here.
Oh, are they really? I've been golfing for a good year now and I've gotten a lot better, but still, you know, I challenge myself every day. I'm treating it like baseball, honestly. I want to get really good at it. So I've been playing quite a bit and it's filling that void for now. But yeah, I'm not torn with anything. If I don't ever come back to play baseball, I'm okay with it. I'm pretty happy right now.
So 1 year into golfing, I have to ask, what sort of scores are you shooting?
I say low 80s right now. I've had a bunch of scores in the 70s, but I think on average, I'd probably shoot around 80 to 82, 83.
Damn. That's like your fastball.
Right?
So when you go into your golf swing, do you go really, really, really slow and then come around and then all of a sudden hit it like crazy? Like, is there a change-up version of a golf swing?
So I used to when I first started, and I would slice the ball pretty bad. But nowadays, you know, after playing for a full year, I've learned a lot. And now I try to keep my backswing about the same speed as my, you know, going forward swing. And I can hit the ball pretty well. Like I said, I've gotten a lot better, but there's still a lot of improvement left.
I don't like to get all technical because we're more about people than we are about technical stuff. But you mentioned that with the golf swing. When you would throw a changeup, would there be a conscious timing thing that you'd have to go through in your head as you're about to throw it? Because to me, a changeup is a pitch that if it's not thrown precisely correct, you're screwed.
Yeah, it is one of those pitches that even, you know, myself, when I didn't throw it right, it got hit a long ways. So, there's nothing that like went through my head while I was pitching about how to throw a changeup. It's just something that came naturally, I guess. Once I picked it up, it didn't take me very long before I used it in the game and, you know, figured out that it's a pretty good pitch. So it just kind of came naturally, to be honest with you.
What was it about your changeup? Because your changeup, you know, most pitchers, the success of their changeup kind of relies on keeping hitters off balance. But you were one of those rare pitchers, you know, the hitter could know that that changeup was coming, but they still couldn't time it up. They still couldn't square it up. What was it about your changeup that distinguished it from your contemporaries?
I have no idea. I've asked hitters before what it looked like, because I had no clue. All my goal was just to make it look like a four-seam fastball.
When I'm throwing a fastball, I mean, you're always going to load, but you push off of it, right?
Yeah.
You push off, at least I do. When I'm throwing a changeup, I'm still back here, and as I release, I try to stay back as long as I can with that back leg.
That was the only goal I had, and obviously to make it a little bit slower than your fastball, which wasn't hard for me, but I would ask hitters that, and they would tell me exactly what I was hoping was, you know, it looked just like my four-seam fastball, but it would never get there. So obviously that's going to throw off anybody's timing. And that's all I wanted to hear. So my goal was just to have that same four-seam spin on the ball. And it seemed like I was doing it right.
So when you were having a not so good day on the mound, was it like, is it easy enough to look back now and attribute it to something relatively simple? And who's your friend?
It's this axe right here.
Oh, nice.
Little dachshund sample here. He's a great dog. Yeah, he's a year old now. He's a lot of fun.
Nice. Yeah. So like, were you able to look back on days where you just didn't have it?
And
oh, there's a lot of days.
Well, I mean, not to compare it at all to like R.A. Dickey, but because that was a feel pitch, and to me, a changeup is a feel pitch that, you know, you could feel physically great going on the mound. All your other pitches could be working great, but you just don't have the feel for the changeup.
Yeah, there was plenty of those days, and I hated it. But, you know, even on those days, I was able to get away with a lot because I was, you know, it's one of those pitches that if, you know, even if it's off, if you just keep it down, you should still be pretty successful. But for the most, yeah, it's just, man, I had way too many of those, and it was scary. It's scary going out there without a changeup, you know, because I wasn't throwing it by guys. It's not like I threw 95 or 100. So without that changeup, it made pitching a little more difficult. But the days that I did feel like it was on, I felt invincible. It's a good feeling to be out there knowing, man, I've got my changeup down. But also, you know, your fastball location. If you have fastball location, that's all you need.
Speaking of the fastball, that seems to be the key to success for so many young players. And, you know, baseball is one of those games where people like to emulate other players. And it seems right now we're in an era where everybody wants that, you know, 99 mile an hour fastball. Everyone wants the hard cutter, the hard slider. Why isn't it that, you know, with all the arm injuries, with all the Tommy John, why aren't there more players out there perfecting a changeup? Or is it just that difficult to pitch that there are people trying and they're not, you know, unable to emulate your success?
It's just the feel pitch. It's such a feel pitch. And some guys, I think guys that do throw harder just have a little more, a tougher time trying to have that feel, I guess. But there are plenty of guys that throw really hard and have a great changeup. It's just, I don't think it really matters if you throw hard or slow. It's just a feel pitch. And some guys have it, some guys don't. Yeah, I don't know. It should be a pitch that everybody has. I think it's definitely a great weapon to have.
Marco, we have a pretty big group here of your fans, and it really goes to show the impact that you made during your time as a Toronto Blue Jay. When you look back on that now, just to know that there are this many people that want to sit here in this chat room and ask you a question, what does that mean to you?
Oh, it means a lot. I had such a good time in Toronto. And I always said it was my second home. I just felt comfortable. The fans were always amazing. You know, whether I was pitching good or bad, it didn't matter. Most of the people out there were, you know, treated me kindly, and it meant a lot to me. I just had a really good time out there in Toronto, and I miss it.
Well, I'm going to ask you if you remember this. This was maybe 3 years ago. You were still with the Blue Jays, and one of our regular listeners to our show lives in Pakistan, and he'd get up at 4 o'clock in the morning, and his name was Usman, and you had some cleats and a glove and stuff that you wanted to send to him. Well, for the first time, Usman is actually joining us right now from Pakistan. Usman, say hello to Marco. First of all, what time is it in Pakistan right now?
Well, right now it's 1:15 a.m. in the morning, so it's like Monday right now, not Sunday for me.
That's incredible.
So
here's your opportunity, Usman. What would you like to say to Marco?
Yeah. Well, first off, how are you doing, Marco?
It's great. Usman, doing great, man. Thank you so much for following my career. It means a lot, and it's special. It's 1 a.m. You're up, you know, doing this with us, so it means a lot. Appreciate it.
Usman, though, it's great that you're hanging out with us here. So we're gonna keep you on the line here. We're gonna bring everyone else in the room now. So while I'm doing that, Marco, other than golf, I know you've always talked about being a big car person. So have you been working with your cars, restoring them, adding to the collection? I'm selling cars now, by the way. So if you do want to, if you want a Honda Civic or something, I can get you a good deal.
Haven't learned to repair them just yet, but I just purchased a 72 Bronco at Barry Jackson. And that's in the shop. It's being taken care of. So I'm really excited about this thing. See how it comes out.
Are you more of a collector, or do you like to get them out there on the road? And
I do have two cars that I don't drive. I did tell my wife one day that there is money to be made in this, and she doesn't believe me. So I told her I'd prove her wrong. So I'm waiting for these cars to be worth more than what I initially paid for them, which they already are. So I just need to make some money on these to show her that you can make some money collecting cars, because she doesn't believe me.
I don't know if I believe you either. I sell cars for a living. I know they just lose value every day.
Well, when you have, so one of them's it's just a 2000 Cobra R, nothing special, but they only made 299 of these. Mine has 500 miles, so it just sits there. And this car is already worth more than what I initially paid for it. So that is one. Yeah.
Do you have a car in your collection that is just too important for you to drive? Like you would never even drive it because it is just too delicate. Like this is my baby. It sits here. I will not drive it.
No, I drive them all. I have a 67 GT500 that I restored, and I haven't been driving it the last year. I've had some brake issues, even though it's just an old body, but brand new everything. But the company I used didn't do a great job. So I won't really drive it yet till these brakes get fixed. And obviously COVID hit, so I didn't want to drive anywhere with it or do anything. So, but now that things are starting to get better out here, I made plans to have it repaired. So once that gets fixed, I'll be driving it quite a bit.
Okay, we've got a number of people that would like to talk to you, so we're going to get started right away, and let's begin with Natalie.
Hi, Marco, I'm Natalie.
Hi, Natalie, how are you?
Oh, good, I got my kids here, they're just being shy, they don't want to be on the video. we really enjoyed watching you play when you were with the Jays, and certainly I think all fans miss you. I guess the question we were thinking of, wanted to ask you when you were playing, was there a batter that you found the most difficult to face, and one that you usually that you remember that you had their number, that he was maybe more of an easy out, right? That one that you had their number.
There's a ton of guys I had trouble with, but I think the most difficult at bats would be against either Yadi Molina or Starling Castro. For some reason, they just always put together a great at-bat. Even if I got them out, they just found ways to waste pitches. It was always frustrating. Molina had a lot of hits off of me, and so did Castro. And even though Castro's weren't great contact on most of them, it's just he always found a way to get on against me. It was frustrating. And then someone I had success against was actually Mookie Betts. I don't know what he was off of me, I guess, but I remember just doing really well against him for some reason.
Marco, in some ways, does it ever become mental where you just feel so good up against some guy because you've had the success? And likewise, a guy comes to the plate and you just feel, oh, man, this guy, like, are you aware that a guy's had your number when he's facing you?
Yeah, I think it's one thing that does come up. You know, it's in the back of your head. You try not to think about it while you're on the mound. But also, I actually just spoke to someone about this the other day because they asked a similar question. And I told them, I swear hitters can, like, smell blood. So if you're feeling any sort of insecurity, they're going to know. And vice versa. I feel like when a hitter was going up there and already felt defeated, I could feel it. And it would, I don't know, I would pitch better against them for some reason. But you do feel those things. It's weird.
Awesome. All right. Thank you, Natalie, for your call and your question. And let's bring it now to – I got so many people on here. Yes, Randy, you're a first time on the show. So there you go. Say hello to Marco.
Good afternoon, Marco. Pleasure to meet you.
How you doing? Nice to meet you.
I'm well, thank you. My question for you is, through your career, do you have a crowning moment that you look back on and say, oh, that was amazing. I loved that.
Oh, I mean, I think most people remember this about me was when I walked off the mound game 5 against the Royals. I've never had an ovation like that. It was unreal. I wish I could relive it all over again just to walk off that mound and hear the crowd go nuts. It was a special moment, something I'll never forget.
How about winning $20 off me in a bet? That was pretty high up there, wasn't it?
Oh, anytime I get to take your money, Barry, it's up there.
For those that are not aware, you had some laugh at my expense about a potentially drop ball in the camera bay, and you didn't think I could catch a ball again. And you bet me $20 at the next ball that came my way I would miss. And I don't think I missed it, but you claim I did. And I paid you.
100% you did.
And I paid you in Canadian money, and you weren't really thrilled with that either, were you?
It's okay. Hey, it was worth just seeing you try to catch a ball.
All right, enough of me. Susan, let's get to Susan here.
Hi, Marco. Thank you for doing this. Great to see you. You look great.
Thank you, Susan. Nice to meet you.
And I just wanted to tell you how you felt about when you went on that winter tour, going to the Western provinces, how cold it was for you. How did you enjoy that?
Oh, man, that was one of the tours we went to, did you say Regina? I couldn't hear, but one of them was Regina. And
yes.
That's by far the coldest place I've ever been. I don't remember, it might have been minus like 50 or something. I don't remember. It was ridiculous. It was a lot of fun for the first like 5 minutes being out there. And then it really hits you. And you can't have enough clothing on you to keep the cold out. And it was something, it was a lot of fun. I'm glad I got to experience it, but I'm okay where I live right now in Arizona.
I'll bet you are. Thank you.
Thank you. Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you too.
Susan, thank you so much. You know, we talked a little bit off the top about just how things are different here in Canada right now than they are in the States, COVID-wise. How are things in Arizona? Because, I mean, all we hear about is, you know, everything's pretty much back to being open again there.
It really is. You know, the first year, I just listening to family members that live in California, what they had to deal with was nothing close to what we've had to deal with. Yeah, we were shut down here and there, but for a few weeks, maybe nothing crazy. And then it slowly started opening up. And today it's pretty open right now. I actually went to dinner with a wife last night and I got out wearing a mask and the security guards tell me, dude, you know, we don't have to wear those anymore. I'm like, wait, I don't have to wear the mask in there? I'm like, okay. Took it off and walked right in. It was weird because I wear a mask everywhere I go. You know, I just want to be respectful to everybody else. But if no one else is wearing it and it's okay, then I guess I won't wear it.
Man, yeah.
It was a nice feeling. It was weird, but it was nice.
I think most of us have forgotten what that life is like. So, all right, Randy, thank you for your question. And Sue, thank you for your question. And let's go to Fiona next.
Hi, Marco. It's nice to meet you.
Hi, Fiona. Nice to meet you.
I'm just wondering, if you hadn't made a career out of being a baseball player, what would you have chosen as your career?
So I actually went to school and was majoring in criminal justice. My uncle, he works at a juvenile hall, and it looked like he did really well for himself. So I kind of wanted to take that route. I was thinking either that or some sort of like parole officer. But baseball just ended up working out, luckily.
Oh my God. How have I never heard this before?
You've never asked.
Well, see, this is why we have to have our...
Every week we say that our viewers get better questions in than we do. So here we go. Here's another one.
Yeah. Wow. So was that something that you really seriously, like, there was a time when you thought, you know, I want to do this? Or was that a backup plan and baseball was pretty much on your radar from a very young age?
Well, plan A was to get school paid for. And once that happened, I started realizing that I might have a chance at making something out of it. But, you know, I was trying to get my bachelor's in criminal justice, and I was a year away from getting it. But obviously, once baseball started up, it's really hard to go back. So, I mean, it's pretty awesome that there's been so many players that go back and get their degrees. I know when Stroman was injured, he had a chance to go back and finish, and I thought that was really cool. But yeah, I never got to finish, but it's okay. Things worked out.
Come on. Devin Travis went and finished his schooling.
Mm-hmm. Devin Travis, man.
Yeah. So, you know, I don't know if you realize, Devin and Michael Saunders are both now working in the Atlanta Braves organization and in the coaching department for the minor league system. Is coaching something that you think you ever might want to do?
I think one day. Right now I'm having way too much fun, and you know, I've missed so much of my kids' life that I just want to be involved right now. So I don't want to go away unless, you know, someone offers me some sort of job here in Arizona. But I think in the future, yeah, I could see myself maybe trying that out for a bit. But I knew about Devin Travis. We still keep in contact pretty often, so I knew about him. I had no idea about Saunders, so that's pretty cool. I'm happy for them.
Yeah, Saunders is the manager, and Devin is he's doing something, you know, working with. Yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm. All right. Speaking of spending time with their kids, my co-host Tom here feels the best way to spend time with his kid is to actually invite his kid to sit in on the conversation. So, our youngest person on the line here is Liam, and I'm trying to get Liam to unmute his audio so we can hear him. There he is.
There we go.
Who also happens to be Tom's son and a fan of yours, Marco. So, Liam, say hello to Marco. And Liam is also, by the way, I'm going to tell you this, one day we'll be pitching in the major leagues. That's just my prediction.
Hi, Marco. Nice to meet you. My question is, do you have any tips for a younger pitcher to get better?
You know what? The hardest thing for me was being told no, I couldn't do something, and not listening to them. You know, that was the biggest thing for me that, you know, that pushed me the hardest, was always taking that criticism and turning it into something positive. I worked really hard. I didn't care what anybody told me. I just always had in my mind that I was going to get there. So I pushed really hard, regardless of what the naysayers said. So, you know, it's just to never give up. And I'm sure you've heard that many times, but it's really the truth. If you really want something bad enough, you can easily get it.
Okay. Thank you.
You got it, bud.
Tom, you want to follow anything up there?
Marco, thank you so much. So this isn't actually generally how I spend time with my son, but this is the first time Liam's asked to come and take part in one of these chats. And he did, because I guess he would have been about 6 years old in 2016 watching those games. And you were one of the first pitchers that he emulated. And he is a pitcher in AAA rep here. And thank you so much for giving him that advice and, you know, talking to him.
He's got to work hard, you know, keep your head down, work hard and enjoy what you're doing.
Do you remember the first time you saw a fan with an Estrada jersey? And I'd have to think that'd be like a really surreal thing to see a kid wearing your jersey.
I actually don't remember the first time I saw one. I did see a few out there, but it's...
Oh, come on.
Come on. A few.
A couple. But yeah, no, it's a cool feeling to know you have supporters out there that are willing to even buy a jersey with your last name on it. It was a lot of fun to see. Yeah, I really appreciated that stuff.
Awesome. All right. Let's go to Matthew, who's been waiting patiently. And Matthew, I'm just unmuting your audio here so you can, there you go. Matthew, say hello to Marco and fire away.
Hey, Marco. How much are you doing this? Glad to see you doing well.
I appreciate it. Thank you.
Yeah. I was just thinking, you were mentioning about the, that you, like, when you had your mask on when you went to the restaurant and the officer told you to take it off. Like, have you gotten vaccinated or have any of your families gotten?
No, I haven't yet. He didn't tell me to, but he said it's, you don't need it. No, I have not been vaccinated. I have family members that have been. There's basically a list. You know, you start with the older crowd, they're getting vaccinated, it just kind of trickles down. So it's not really quite my turn yet. And I'm still undecided on what I'm going to do when I get the opportunity.
Oh, wow. And actually, baseball related. I remember your delivery. You had a high knee kick, I remember, when you were with the Jays. Have you always had that, like, pitching delivery, or how did it develop?
Yeah, it slowly kind of morphed into something different. But if you look back in my younger days, when I actually could throw hard, my delivery was a little bit different. And then as I... you know, the more time I spent in the big leagues, the more I wanted to focus on just locating and stop trying to overthrow. So I made a few tweaks here and there. And, you know, what the final product was, you know, when I was with the Blue Jays, that's what felt comfortable. That's what felt like I could control the baseball the most. So, that was just the delivery I worked on to try and locate the most.
You know, something I never gave much thought of until – maybe about a month or so ago when we had Jason Fraser on the show, and he talked about all the crap that would go through his mind between each pitch, which is why he took so much time between pitches, because he had all these thoughts going on in his head. What would go on through your head between pitches? Was there a pattern? Was there something that you would say to yourself, or any kind of regular thought that would go through your head?
No. So when I first came up, I was the same way. I would try to remember all the scouting reports and, tell myself, well, you better make sure you place this pitch perfect. And I would get in trouble when I would do that stuff. And I've said this a million times, I talked to Burley and he just said, trust your catcher, have confidence behind the pitch. And if you do that, you'll be a lot more successful. Take all that other stuff out of the game. You know, the game's hard enough as it is, so don't overthink anything. And sure enough, I stopped doing scouting reports. Whatever the catcher called, I went after it. I was committed to the pitch, and I think that helped me out a ton. That's kind of what brought my playing skills, I guess, to the next level, and why I had so much success in, or at least 15 and 16 over there in Toronto.
What would happen on a day that you were getting rocked, though? Like, would it be that much harder to not? Because human nature is, I'm better than this. Why are they hitting my pitches so much today?
I would always, and this is no joke, I would tell myself it's because I missed the pitch. I didn't locate. Like, I would tell myself, you got lucky on that. When things were going really well and I was on the mound and someone would, let's just say, hit a home run, I would get the ball back and tell myself, man, like, you got lucky because I made a bad pitch. So I would let it go really, really quick. But it was, I never gave credit to anybody in terms of hitting, and obviously these guys are so talented. It's incredible what they do. But in the time of pitching, at least for me, because I wanted to be mentally strong, it was always, I made the mistake. That's the only reason why you hit it.
All right, we have one more question for you, and this one comes from John. So, John, say hello to Marco.
Hey, Marco. Great to meet you. Marco, other than your pitching, one of the things that always impressed me about you was your close relationship with your mother. And you always spoke so fondly of her, and it, as a person, it, I loved you because of that, because of your relationship with your mother. Now, I have a question. I read that your nickname is Estrada Bien.
Yeah.
What is that?
Oh man, it's a weird, it's not weird, but in, so like Dominican players have a saying, Estrada Bien, which I still don't really know what it means. They tried explaining it to me and it just, yeah, I'm not really sure how to use it in like a sentence or something, but they kept saying that Estrada Bien. I'm like, yeah, it sounds like Estrada Bien. So that's the only reason why I ended up using it. But Batista would use that word really often. And I always thought he was like calling my name or something, but I was like, no, that's the word I've never really heard. So I was like, I'm going to tie it in and just, you know, make it my own and Estrada Bien.
Yeah, I love that.
Speaking of Joey Bats, over the last couple of years, we've seen some videos of him actually pitching. And I think there's word that if there was a World Baseball Classic, he would pitch for the Dominican. I mean, you were a teammate of his, and you saw the work ethic that guy put in. Any doubt in your mind that he could pretty much do anything he wanted to do athletically?
100%. 100%. I mean, he always had a good arm. You know, he was injured one year where I think he hurt his shoulder. And it probably knocked off a few miles per hour, I guess, during that span. But I'm sure he's worked his butt off, and he does everything the right way. So if he wants to pitch, he will pitch, and we'll probably see him soon.
Are you still following baseball at all? You watching MLB?
You know what? I didn't so much last year. I'm trying to get into it right now. And I thought it was going to be hard to watch games, but it's been a lot of fun. I watch a lot of my buddies that are still playing. I like to watch them. There isn't really a team that I follow. It's more of the guys. You know, I think most people know I was really close with like Jay Happ and Aaron Sanchez. And so those guys, you know, every time they're on, I try to watch them.
I was going to ask you about Sanchi because to me, it's one of those really heartwarming, great stories to see in baseball because I think – a lot of people had written him off completely, the Blue Jays included. And now he's back and he looks fantastic. And it's just so great to see. And it's a perfect lesson that never give up until you know, that's why. And I totally understand that's why you're saying, I'm not announcing any retirement until I'm told I can never do this again.
Right, exactly. But yeah, he's doing great out there. He looks great. He's pitching really well. I'm really excited for him. He's earned every bit of it. You know, I knew the struggle he was going through with injuries and, you know, just missing all of last year. I know it was hard for him. So to see him back on the mound and doing as well as he's doing, I couldn't be prouder for him. And just, yeah, I'm really excited just to see him dominate this year.
You know, with all the changes that have been happening in MLB since COVID, something that we get into quite often with players is what they think of them. Specifically, the runner on second to start extra innings, or we had the 7-inning no hitter just last week, I think it was. Looking as someone who's from the game, how are you feeling about these changes? Is it taking it in the right direction or the wrong direction?
I mean, I was fine with the way baseball was. I do. I know when I was playing, I wanted 7-inning doubleheaders because, I mean, that's a lot of baseball. You know, guys get tired and there's usually not enough arms to cover these games. So I'm good with the 7 innings. I think that's a great idea. The runner on second, that one's a little more difficult. I think they should have a whole nother like stat for those guys because – you know, if that guy scores, it's on whoever's pitching, you know, and this guy might not even give up a hit. You know, he gives up a sac fly to right field, the runner tags, goes to third. Next guy hits another pop fly, he tags, scores. Next guy strikes out, you didn't give up a hit or anything, but you give up a run and you just lost the game. So That one's iffy. And I get what they're trying to do. They're trying to speed up the game and whatnot, but that one's tough. I'm not sure how I feel about it yet.
I don't know. As somebody who's watched the game my whole life, I don't care the actual how long a game goes. I just want it to be a good game. I've seen 3-4 hour games that have been phenomenal, and I've seen 2 hour games that have really sucked. So to me, it's more the pace than the length, if that makes any sense.
For sure. And I was just watching a few days ago, the Padres and Dodgers. That entire series was awesome. But they had a game where they went extra innings. And that was the first time I had seen that, where they had the runner on second. And at the before I even saw an inning of this, I was like, that's such a crazy idea. Why are they doing this? Like, it doesn't make any sense. And watching that, just watching them go back and forth, it was pretty cool, but I still don't completely agree.
I can hear Liz, but I don't see Liz. But Liz, if you're there, go ahead and ask Marco your question.
Hi, I just wanted to. I'm good. How are you?
I'm doing great. Thank you. It's good to hear from you.
It's good to hear from you, too. Listen, I wanted to say how much I was thinking about you the other day when I was going through some of the pictures I took, and I saw some amazing. I always remember how awesome you were with all the little kids, well, with all the fans. But I just remember one time you'd been out running around chasing your Frisbee around, and there were these two little kids, and you're like, and you stopped, and you were so amazing with them. And those are one of many reasons, you know, we fans in Toronto love you. I was going to say, the other thing I wanted to ask you is, have you been to Vegas?
I just came back from it like a week or two ago. Mm-hmm. We had so much fun.
Oh, that's great, Marco. That's awesome. It sounds like you're having a great time, and that's wonderful about your dog.
I try to stay away from Vegas because it's dangerous out there. But yeah, he keeps calling me back. We had a blast last time.
That's awesome, Marco. Well, it's really nice to talk to you. Take care of yourself and your family.
Thank you, Liz. Thank you. From you. Appreciate everything.
Great way to wrap things up. Again, Marco, stay well. It's always great to have you come on the show. I'm glad that you're feeling good. I'm glad you're getting some great time in with the kids. And any of them playing sports or what?
Volleyball. She's actually doing really well. She's pretty. I think she got my genes on that one. And my son, he's playing soccer. He did skip this season because we weren't sure what was going on. But I think it just ended yesterday, so they should start back up again pretty soon. And when they do, he'll be back playing soccer. He's enjoying it. So it's been a lot of fun watching them play, man. I get a little too amped up, though. I'm not the crazy dad that's always yelling and doing all that, but you know, I sit quietly in a corner somewhere, but deep down inside, I am screaming louder than anybody. It's crazy. I get more nervous watching them than when I would go in pitch. It's crazy.
Are you serious? Are you one of those parents that you know, is at some point going to have to be taken out of the...
Never. No one ever knows what's going on with me. I'm just quiet there, you know, and I was just enjoying it. But inside, yeah, I'm yelling, screaming, doing everything.
Are you able to live a pretty anonymous life these days where people don't know who you are?
Oh, in Arizona, yeah, it's really easy to do here. It's only happened a few times where someone recognized.
All right. And coming up on next week's show, we're going to be talking to former Toronto Blue Jay Jesse Litch. At the time of recording, we have not done this yet. It looks like this will be recorded on Monday. So if you are watching or listening to this on Sunday, there is still time to get in and be part of the Zoom with Jesse Litch.
Well, everyone here does. And you did say it was one of the greatest moments of your career and you would like to relive it again. So everyone, let's say goodbye to Marco Estrada as he leaves the Zoom.
Right, everybody.
Thank you. Thanks, Marco.
Thanks, Marco.
Come on.
Thank you. Yay.
There you go. There we go. There's former Toronto Blue Jay, Marco Estrada. What a fantastic conversation. God, that guy was just a lot of fun to chat with, Thomas. And again, folks, if you want to get in on one of these Zooms and join in the conversation, and even when there's a lot of people in the Zoom like we had this week, you still get your one-on-one time. Thomas, how can someone get involved?
Again, it's a media experience and like no other. You can just visit patreon.com/out of the park. $3 a month, $5 a month. You can come on every week. We're talking to a different Blue Jay or baseball professional. And the conversations go to some crazy places and you can get in on them. $3, $5 a month. Join us in this amazing format.
So once again, a big thank you to Marco Estrada for joining us on the program. Thanks to Julia from the Jaywalk and, of course, Raj Sapaya. Go to thejaywalk.com. Follow them on Twitter at thejaywalk. It's the_jaywalk. Foundationphysiotherapy.com. Follow Raj Sapaya. And Tom, yes, I know you're a fantastic golfer, but I myself personally have hit a few birdies in my lifetime of golfing. I've also hit a few seagulls and I believe a pigeon.
A barn.
Yes, yes, yes. We've all hit barns, I'm sure.
You have.
Tom, thank you as always to all of you. Thank you so much for making us a part of your week.